I'm going to go ahead and turn over the mics to our guests. We've got three games in this block, and that's Diaries of Spaceport Manager, Little Bug, and just Manager, a Janitor. That's the sequel. That's where you're like, I'm going to take my revenge on the Spaceport. And then also Little Bug and the Norwood Suite. So everybody, a round of applause for our guests. And I'll let you guys introduce yourselves, starting with James.
Hello, everyone. I'm James Shasha. I'm from Vermont, where, well, I'll get into that, though. I'm James Shasha, at @videojames_ on Twitter.
I'm Greg from New York. CosmoDDD is my Twitter handle. And I'm happy to be here.
I'm Bella. I'm from Los Angeles with Buddy System, and this is the other half of Buddy System, Jamie.
Hi, I'm Jamie.
So I guess I'll start with Diaries of a Spaceport Janitor. Diaries of a Spaceport Janitor is an anti-adventure game about cleaning up trash at an alien bazaar. Which some of you guys might be familiar with. Basically, it started 2 years ago when me and my roommate were basically brainstorming ideas to do a video game because we had just released we had finished our first sort of project that we had finished to completion and put available on the internet to play. And we were like, okay, that was cool, but we want to do something weird now that's strange and perhaps unusual and unique. Because the game that we had made before that, while being cool, was sort of not boring, but is an action platformer. And we were ready to experiment a little bit and also go into 3D because we had just started getting used to Unity, and I was feeling ready to kind of expand. So what became an idea between the two of us ended up expanding into obviously a much bigger game than we originally intended. We were okay, so we just finished a game and we want to make something weird and small, and it'll be done in 2 weeks to 2 months max. And now 2 years later, it's released on Steam last week and itch.io. Thanks. Gosh. So if you guys want it, definitely go over to itch.io, tinybuild.itch.io, and you can pick it up there. And also on there is the bonus content, which is available, and you guys have already been enjoying the screen toy, which is included in that bonus content. So if you want your computer to become melting, glitchy colors, you should go to itch.io and pay more than $11.11 for our game, and you will also be able to do that. So I guess I'll just run through who we are Sunday month real quick. I am only one of us. There's a bunch of us. We're a games collective. And like I said, we are from Vermont, which is a really nice place, but it's also very small and there's not a lot of game developers there, so we're kind of looking to leave. We like it, and it was a good place for us to meet. We met at Champlain College in Burlington. I originally personally started there in the game design program, and then ended up switching out to an art major, which gave me more freedom to do indie games as weird art projects, basically. And so living in Burlington, we sort of met each other and started this company. So there's a bunch of us, and we have a lot of things going on because we are a collective. Basically, our company model is we have a horizontal sort of leadership structure that we're still figuring out, actually. But then we have several teams working on different projects all at once. So there's Diaries of a Spaceport Janitor, which has been going on for the past 2 years, obviously. And I'm the programmer on that project, and also I sort of wear a lot of hats, so y'all are probably familiar with what it's like to do an indie game. Basically, I like program, and I also do some art and writing and design and what have you, like whatever needs filling in. But then we also have two musicians, one of whom also did all the sound effects, four, five different artists. Some of our friends like came and did like one or two sprites for the game, that kind of thing. Like my roommate did like the festival musicians. And then, who am I forgetting? I think that's everyone. But then, we also had like a producer slash writer slash community manager. And then, so that's one team in Sunday Month. And then our other big project is Dad Quest, which just went through Steam Greenlight a couple of months ago. We've just hit like serious development phase for it. We're hoping it'll come out next year. And that's being published by Excalibur Games. And we actually just showed that at EGX last week in London. So I will play the Dad Quest Greenlight trailer so you guys can get a sense of what it is if you haven't already seen it. It's very different from Diaries. Go. Is the volume good? Yeah, I think it's good. So Dad Quest is a game where you have an indestructible child that you use as a weapon and you throw it at enemies to deal damage. You can also, sort of like, but you can also throw it through buildings to level it up. And then when your dad dies, the child becomes the new dad, and you sort of continue the legacy. And there may or may not be some other, like, stranger things afoot. Yes.
I have a question about Dad Quest. Was there any real life inspiration for this? Any anecdotal origin behind it?
I don't know if I can really speak to that. I wasn't part of the like original concept of Dad Quest. I've just sort of been like in the company. Basically, what we do is like we support each other's projects and like we jump in and out and sort of like fill in the gaps whenever something is needed. And then we also have more than just these two projects. We have a lot of stuff going on, so I can't really speak too much to the exact inspiration for Dad Quest. I know we had originally made it to pitch to, I think, Adult Swim, actually. We pitched it to them, and we ended up doing a Kickstarter to sort of, like, I guess, like, show that we have, like, interest and momentum. So that was last fall. And it worked out, and out of that, we got Excalibur Games to publish the game. So it worked out, and we're all really excited about it. We have just sort of all the footage from that trailer is from like our Kickstarter demo from last year, so it's like old. We just finished a demo for EGX like last week or 2 weeks ago, and that's in our brand new engine. We built an engine for it over the summer, which may or may not have been the best idea. I'll let you guys know next year. That's Dad Quest. I think what I was going to do now, I guess, was just, like, I guess, play the game a little bit, Diaries, or if someone wants to, like, one of you guys maybe wants to, like, play, because I've played it, obviously I made it. So, just to, so everyone can get, like, an idea.
Should I use a Xbox controller?
Yeah, here, I'll plug this in for you. And I'll just do, like, commentary, I guess.
Perfect. Also, if I'm, like, doing things, like, totally wrong, or, like, places that aren't right, then, like...
I mean, the idea is that, like, you can't play it wrong.
Well said.
But we'll see what happens. Yeah, wait, why isn't it... Oh, it doesn't matter. These are all the same anyway. And if anyone has any questions or anything, just, like, please shout them out. That was, like, the extent of all of the structure that I had planned for this, so we're just winging it together now. That's the most important choice in the whole game. Fun fact.
Well, I just, like, went for it, because I like the art. So.
No, that's what's important.
That's important.
So I guess for anyone who's not familiar, basically in this game, you are the janitor, obviously. And it sort of throws you in without really any guidance at all. But the idea is that you are, like, really poor and you have always wanted to just, like, get off of this planet. And that's kind of the setup. And then one day, something amazing happens. And yeah, having all of these food stalls and stuff in the starting area, I think really confuses people. But we're okay with that. Yeah, I don't know what that is. It's an alien creature. One of the first things that people usually comment on is, like, the art style. So, the sort of, like, 2D and 3D, like, feeling. Oh, yeah. Oseb is the guy to go to.
This is, Unity?
So we use Unity 3D. You probably... I'm going to railroad you a little. Go back into the bank. So, if you press Y, you can grab your inventory and pull up those bone coins. So the idea is, like, there's several money objects in the game, and each one of them has, like, something wrong with them. So the Naui bone coins are, like, cursed, but they're also money.
Which is just money in general, so.
Yep. So if you keep that and then go to the guy at the back of the room, back right.
Back right.
Yep.
The baby with the gun, or
no? This guy, this money lender.
Okay.
He will buy it from you.
Oh, I see. Okay, I didn't get that when I originally played it.
Yeah, that's really. It's not explained anywhere.
That's okay though. It's like nice exploring.
Yeah. So you can. Oh no, you want to, like, sell it to him probably.
Okay. Oh, okay. So I move it over here.
Right.
Gotcha.
So see, now you're rich.
I actually don't see how I'm rich.
Oh, your money is in the top left. Things we never thought to explain to the player. You just have to figure this shit out. Yeah. Don't buy anything except for what you need, though, because you can break the game.
And also because I'm a lowly janitor, I need to save up.
Right.
I
want to
talk to this person.
On the art style, I guess we... From the start, we knew that, like, the core gameplay or whatever was just gonna be, like, walking around and, like, picking up trash, basically. So to kind of offset that, like, mundanity, we were like, well, let's have as much trash and as many characters walking around the spaceport as possible. So because of those decisions, we were like, well, the easiest way for us to have that much like 2D content or that much like characters and trash and stuff is definitely just to. Oh, you should eat the eye before you go in there and like walk around.
Okay, so I'm gonna press. Then I'm gonna press Y. And then I'm gonna click on that. I'm gonna eat it.
Yep, and then don't go straight in. Just like walk around.
Okay.
Because something cool happens when you eat the eye of Beb. So in order to like mass produce characters, we wanted that just led us to do pixel art.
Whoa.
With like really simple animation. Because so we wanted to have a lot of characters.
Wow, this is really cool. Is this the eye of Beb that's making
yes.
me?
Yes. So when you eat the eye of Beb, it puts the game into first person. And also makes you trip the fuck out.
Drought of void breath.
Is the first person mode kind of like an optional mode you can play through throughout the game?
Yep.
And that's like the way you access it? It's like
an
in-game way to access
it. It's also, and we could have shown you guys, it's fine. If you try to go underground, it'll tell you that it's bad luck to go underground without eating one of those eyes. The idea was that we wanted all of the underground segments to be in first person, and this was kind of an organic way of like forcing the player to do that.
Oh wow, this person's all hairdo. Okay, so would it be a good idea to go underground now?
If you want to, I mean, do whatever you're feeling.
So is my main job here is like when I find stuff on the ground, like, okay, so this looks like it's something on the ground.
Yep.
Do I mostly want to like be keeping things or do I want to be incinerating them?
Almost everything that you pick up can be sold in the spaceport. That being said, not all of it is very valuable. In fact, most of it is like not worth much. And it's also very, very difficult to like know which merchants will purchase which items. So for the most part, like, the game is about like sorting through trash on the ground. So if you like something, you can keep it, but you don't have a lot of space in your inventory. And also everything is super expensive.
Yeah, that doesn't look like something I can afford right now.
It's also not something you really need, unless it is, so.
89.3 is also the NPR in LA. So
oh, really?
That's cool.
That's how much money
it is. It's an aspirational brand. In the spaceport.
And so you can also, all merchants will buy and sell the same things, the same items. They all sell the same items that they buy. And you can tell what that is just by looking at like what's on the table in front of them. Oh shit.
Oh shit. I think my luck did change. So I'm gonna keep that.
Wow.
Did I keep it? Oh, there's
yeah,
more.
You did.
There's nothing noteworthy, but I'm going to keep it anyway.
Okay. Yeah, so you grab that note, and that note says that there might still be treasure underground.
Okay, so now I feel like it's a good time to go see.
Yes.
Because this looks like an underground.
The idea is kind of that you're too smart to go looking for danger, and you know the sprawling treasure chambers beneath this part of town were picked clean long ago.
Yeah, but that note on the ground said I'm going to be lucky, so.
Something beckons to you in the dark.
Mm-hmm. Oh, pretty. So is this, like, real-time light that's up against this, like?
No, well, I mean.
Or is that, like, a shader or something?
No, so it's looking cool like that because it's, like, Unity's default. There's a couple of image effects going on. There's, the one that looks really cool is, the contrast enhancer, which I just like spent a long time like fucking with the settings with, and found out that you could make it. Oh, and then that.
I'm really liking this. I don't know how
that's
it's
like.
But.
That's like super boosted chromatic aberration, actually.
Oh, and it's just like.
It's just like turned to 11, and it makes it like tear up. And then on top of that, there's like a hue-shifting shader that's kind of subtle.
So not to get, like, too technical, but is this, like, chromatic aberration that is just, that's only on the text?
No,
is that
it's
like
on everything. You'll notice, it's easiest to notice it on, like, those gems on the floor and stuff. Like, anything that's, like, red.
Oh, okay, I see, yeah.
So, like,
definitely.
This sign.
Oh, that's,
yeah.
That's interesting.
So this is the intro sequence. Or title card.
Bridge closed until Havilan. I'm guessing Havilan is like a holiday or something. Or
Havilana is actually one of the weekdays. Oh, maybe this is a good time to talk about like the rhythm of the game. Or you can just go for it.
Okay.
So there's 9 days in a week on this planet, and they're each named after one of the 9 goddesses. So Havilana is the day that's named after Havilana.
You kind of just learn this through being in the world and picking up on
in-game
cues and conversations.
So I know maybe a lot of games with something like 9 deities, they might have chosen like a couple of them to be like gods and some of them not to be goddesses. Is there a reason that you chose goddesses for all of them?
Yeah, so they're called goddesses. Gender, I don't know what it is. some of them are like explicitly, well, they use gender neutral pronouns, but they're still goddesses. I don't know.
Is that kind of the reason that you chose like droids to be the like the main sort of character, or?
Oh, because you're. What is happening?
This looks ominous, but I'm gonna just click on it. Okay.
Good.
I feel like that was a good decision.
Probably smart.
Oh, so it's Havilana. So now that bridge is gonna be open down there.
Sure is.
For one thing.
Oh, geez. Is it like just me or is it lagging?
It is lagging.
That's probably fine.
Okay, so this skull now is like, I'm not sure if it's my friend or it's my nightmare. Can't tell.
It's probably both.
Yeah. Yeah, it does seem like a little bit fun. Okay, so turn this on. Cool. Wait, I want to view my luck. Oh, that's not very. I feel like negative 94 is not the best luck to
it's,
have.
It's possible. You want to receive payment.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the game starts every morning with you waking up and like getting your money. And then you go outside. And the way the day-night cycle works is it progresses from morning to night, and then it doesn't go to the next day until you sleep. And in order to sleep, you need to eat. And in order to eat, you need to buy food. And in order to buy food, you need money. And the way you get money is by incinerating trash and getting paid in the morning.
I definitely want to know what a trash crate means. Oh no, so everybody can see that skull, so it's not just like in my imagination.
No, it's there. Okay. It's yelling at you. Yeah, so from this point onward, the game becomes like about picking up trash while an ominous, cursed, floating skull screams at you.
Whatever. That was nice of them to like let me know that I was cursed, though, because I was kind of unsure.
Yeah.
Okay. I want to pick up these little cockroaches, or spiders, or whatever they are, but... Yeah, the hot peppers with legs. Well, I wanted to, like, I don't know, maybe they would increase my luck if I, like, made them my friends. Okay.
How many of those vocal barks did you record for the game?
Yeah, our sound guy did... over 100. There's a lot. There's like unique dialogue sounds for like half of the characters or so. I think like 30 different characters. And they each have like 6 to 12 different little audio clips. Oh, you talk to that person behind you.
Oh, there's a... Okay.
Without spoiling the structure of the game overall...
I didn't even see that person.
Yeah, how's the world sort of structured? Is this like a giant hub world and there's like little dungeons? Are there many like segments of the spaceport?
Yeah, so
Yay.
The environment is kind of the star of the show, I guess. And
not a burrito.
Nah, it's a rock.
Okay.
Sorry. Kind of our idea with the environment was very early on in the process, I was inspired by a story my sister told me about a trip that she took to Morocco, and she got lost in Marrakesh, and like in the bazaar and had to like wander around, and like she kept her cool and found some tourists. But basically the idea of like wandering around in like this very strange place where you don't speak the language and you don't really know anybody, we wanted players to get lost, and we did that a little too well. So the spaceport is kind of a labyrinth, basically. It's a big maze, and it loops around in a really confusing way. And I think I can describe it. Well, okay, a good thing to do, yeah, worship to Onas.
Yeah, that's the one that I chose. Is that the fact that I chose her at the beginning, does that make...
Probably.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't understand most things about this game. So walk around the spaceport in a circle. These like blue pads give you speed boost.
This is the actual spaceport here.
So take a look out to like over there. Oh yeah.
Over here.
Yeah, to the left a little bit, actually.
To the left a little bit more.
Yeah, so like this is one side of the spaceport, and then if you walk around more, it's kind of screwy, but you'll notice you're back at your house over here.
Is that?
Well, I keep going, and then turn to the right. There's Onas.
Okay. Oh, interesting.
So what's happening is basically, not to ruin too much, but under the hood, like the map is a square, but when you walk to like the edge of one side of the square, it like puts you on the adjacent side, like rotated 90 degrees. So basically the way that it works is if you start at any one place in the game and walk in a straight line, you'll eventually come back to where you started from a different angle. And it just makes it like super hard to like actually get used to the space. We wanted to like force people to like build a relationship to the spaceport. So, all right, so yeah, live your dreams, do your job.
So I'm gonna go find something to eat because that seems to be important. So will I kind of like become famished and?
Yeah, you can't die. The only thing that happens is you can't sleep at night if you don't eat.
Okay.
So you need to eat like at least once a day. But for the most part, it's just about exploring and picking up stuff off the ground and incinerating it mostly.
So by incinerating it, when I wake up in the morning, does that mean I'll like get more payment the more stuff I incinerate?
Yeah.
Is that how that works?
Vaguely.
Okay.
A lot of stuff in the game we tried to like intentionally obfuscate. So like it's not very clear like how much you're paid per piece of trash you incinerate. You just sort of... Oh, did you just buy the purple luck wafer?
Yeah, should I eat that? Will that...
It wards off illness.
It wards off illness, and I'm hungry.
Can be eaten for luck.
Okay, but it doesn't make me feel full, though.
No. So it gave you some luck?
So it's like McDonald's french fries.
Oh. But I like very auspicious french fries.
I like the idea that you're discovering what all these things do as you find them, and you don't even know, they're not even reliable in what they say they're going to do, or it's a process of, yeah, discovering that. Was there a specific inspiration for that for you?
Oh, you mean just like items, like the...
Discovering the functionality of the items and the variety of those items.
You just got mugged, buddy.
No. That skull is useless.
Yeah,
that
so you had 100 MC like a second ago, and now you're instantly down. Oh, yo, perfect. Why would anyone use something so sharp for money?
So I'm going to keep that, because I'm going to go...
Cash it in at the bank.
Okay, I can cash it at the bank. Great.
Yeah. In terms of like the items on the ground, like I said, like what we wanted in terms of like content was like to have as much like shit in the game as possible, just in terms of items. So they all have like little descriptions and sort of like, I guess, Dark Souls-y in the sense that like we wanted you to be able to like sort of like learn about the world just
sure.
by like looking at the items in it. Yep, so you can hold 9 items in your backpack and a further 20 items in the chest in your house. But that's still like not a lot of space, especially considering that you're going to want to hold on to like everything you find.
So if I deposit these credit chips, will one of those like bandana guys not?
No, okay, so hit deposit credit chips and it'll tell you that basically the only items that it accepts here are the municipal credit chips.
Oh, okay. And I don't have.
And you don't have any of those. And it tells you to go to the bank in the blue district if you have other currency.
So how do I know where the blue district is? Oh, look at these. They're like twins.
Yeah. There's like arrows on the ground. Oh, also, if you walk up to anyone and hit X, they'll like make their sound at you.
Cute. What?
Huh? Right. Yeah, the idea that people might probably pick up on is, like, you're not the main character in this game. You're, like, in the background. You just walk around and clean up.
Oh, okay, so Blue District. Oh, okay, I get it now. Okay. This is a nice song.
Yeah. Yeah, our musicians did a great job.
Oh, that was nice. Okay, I found the blue district.
Yeah, you can tell by the color of the signs also.
Gotcha. That's cool. Oh, these are... That's... So they mug me and then just take it back to the bank. Which is, like, such a metaphor.
Repo men.
Okay, and I can trade it to this person over here. Right? That's
on the right.
Yeah. That person.
And yeah, if you ever want... the idea is, like, window shopping is highly encouraged, so you can talk to any vendor, including these people in the bank. Like, so, like, this guy over here sells currency, and, like, there's literally no reason for this character to exist in the game. Just, like, hit exchange MC for currency, and you can, like, look at the objects that you could buy. If you had, like,
oh my god,
67,000 municipal credits.
Is that, like, is that you as a designer, like, trolling me? Because I can never have that much? Or
yes,
is that
you
like...
will never, ever have that much money.
That's
You probably won't break 1,000.
Which is funny, because most games where you're, like, collecting loot, like Diablo or something, you just constantly have way too much money, and, like, it's not even really a thing. Like, so that's really funny that you're, like, no, in this game, you literally can't buy anything because you're a janitor.
Right.
Which is funny.
Yeah, and, like, it's maybe a little heavy-handed because, like, it becomes kind of absurd. But, like, the idea is, like, the gold coins, for example, are, like, the currency that the adventurers use. Because, like, in an adventure game, like, that's the, like, standard currency is, like, 5 gold coins for, like, a leather pouch. So everything in this game is, like ludicrously expensive. Like, talk to this bookseller. Like, you could pay 812 credits for a book that doesn't do anything.
I don't know. Central interactive fiction is pretty important, though.
True. So it's getting late, so you could probably find some food, maybe?
Yeah, I'm trying to, like...
Right, so the food stalls, and this isn't communicated either. these, like, it's the stalls which are, like, modeled... Like those, see that one over there? And they've got like food
like
signs.
Like this one is this one or?
Oh, that's a bus.
That's, actually. Okay, that's, yeah.
But yeah, this.
I'm really good at video games. Okay.
But you're in a pretty bougie part of town, so.
Yum, yum. It's all tasty. Oh my god. This is like the equivalent of buying like a quinoa bowl at some like overpriced place.
Yeah. There's a little bit of gentrification in the spaceport.
That's... yeah, seriously. Okay, well, I'm... To be honest, I'm kind of lost. I don't know exactly where to
go. Oh, no.
Oh, no. Can I do dot, dot, dot? Will that work? Okay, cool. Dot, dot, dot works.
You just wanted to harass you.
Yeah, I can't believe nobody is just, like, scared of me because of my skull following me around, but maybe that just happens a lot.
Oh yeah, they're not worried about it. You're the one who's cursed.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, if you follow the yellow arrows, how you get back to your home.
Okay.
And
but
there's
I'm just
like
gonna be
cheaper
up all night.
Food
around
your home.
Gotcha.
And yeah, you guys can probably tell that like it's very maze-like.
Yeah. So, on the art style again. Did you sort of have the idea of making this like a 2D game and then it evolved into 3D and you kept the art style? Was that sort of how that happened? Or?
No, it was 2D and 3D from the start. We, like I said, had had thought to do the 3D environment with 2D characters and objects, just because it was...
Oh, food. Okay, here we go.
...easy to produce a lot of it and have it still look good. And you can also haggle with some of the vendors.
Since we have three games up this morning, we might go ahead and
Yeah, we can totally move on.
Who wants to go next?
So...
Yeah, I'm going to do that
right
now.
That would be a good ending point.
Yeah, I'm going to... Okay, so I'm going to buy that. I'm going to eat it.
And then I'm going...
So I have some street... When you're ready to sleep, follow the yellow arrows home. Okay, so I'm going to follow them home. This is their... Oh, cool. I'm so close. That's great.
You live above a smut shop. which becomes relevant to the plot later.
Cool.
The plot.
And then so once I'm here, do I just kind of like... Do I have a
bed?
Yeah,
so you've got a bed, you have a chest, there's some stuff you can do. And when you sleep, your batteries will recharge.
Because I'm a droid.
Well, I don't know if you're a droid. I like that interpretation. Your incinerator will recharge, at least. Oh, right. You can also use the keyboard and mouse if you don't want to bother. Good. Yeah, so every night you write in your diary before you go to sleep, before the game lets you sleep, and then you wake up in the morning, and Fede is our festival day, so once every 9 days there's like a festival going on that you can kind of hear outside, and I encourage you guys to explore it on your own. And that's Diaries of Spaceport Janitor.
Thank you for guiding me through that. It was really
fun.
Thanks
for playing.
And we'll have an opportunity to ask everybody up there questions at the end of the block.
Do you guys want to go next?
Sure. We can do.
Do you want to go first?
Okay.
Word.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Check out. Let me make sure I have sound here.
Oh, here.
Cool. So, my name's Greg. I go under the handle Cosmo D to some. And I'm going to kick it off with my previous game, just to give you some context. This is the first game I released, and then the game that I will be showing today, or showing at the fest, which is basically the direct follow-up.
Yo, this is like the best game ever, by the way.
I didn't know you made this game. I really like this game.
I didn't know you made this game either.
Thanks.
I was like, Cosmo D, that sounds familiar.
Yeah. Jamie knew, though. Oh.
So this is a game off peak. Let's see if I can get sound going on here.
Oh, yeah, that's important. Hell yes.
Be nice to see it on the big screen. You guys can see it on the big screen, but I'll stick to the laptop. One thing I can do, for those of you who have played it, I can kind of talk a little bit about my influences for the game.
Yes.
And some of the sort of deeper influences that you might not catch at first glance. So right now we're looking around the structure. This is a very New York-centric game. I'm from New York. This is a service sign you would see in a New York City subway. You never want to see this sign. These are all like service changes, which usually means you're waiting for like 20 minutes on a platform. So this is that taken to its logical conclusion.
Just like swim.
Yeah. So this is this blank skyline in the back. I wanted to do something that would sort of convey the larger city that you're in, but I also was thinking about this one day in 2003. You guys might have remembered this if you lived in the Northeast. Around that time, there was a huge blackout. It was like a Northeast regional blackout. There was a computer glitch in a server in Ohio that caused this crazy chain of events that resulted in basically the whole Northeast not having power for about 14 hours, including New York. So there are these pictures of the city just looking like this. No lights. The sun's going down. It was August, so you had the golden hour. And it was just this almost looked like a monolithic ruin. So that was sort of my nod to that fateful day. And then here, this train, this is kind of my nod to the scene at the end of Spirited Away when Chihiro is and her friend, or her spirit friend, are riding this train on the river. And so that's kind of my nod to those things. And this game is full of stuff like that. Like, it's full of nods to this and that, New York-related, and just general kind of pop ephemera. So I won't linger on this too much. He basically gives you the objective of the game. He's trying for you to get a train ticket to get out of the station. But he tore it up, so there are pieces scattered all around. So he sets the scene, he sets you in motion, and off you go. So this is kind of wanted to convey this like totalitarian vibe. Sort of like a little bit Orwell, a little bit Gilliam's Brazil, a little bit like a power plant. Some people here. This is all original music. I wrote it with my band I was in at the time.
Archie Pelago.
Correct. Archie Pelago.
You guys still work making music?
We're not active at this point in time. But who knows? I've gone into development basically full time on my next game, so.
Jamie asked if Archie Pelago floated apart.
Floated apart?
Like an Archie Pelago, I'm guessing.
Yes, like the island masses slowly.
So like there's a lot of like strange sort of political stuff happening.
Yeah.
It feels like, and you get like glimpses of it on this train station here.
Yeah.
Do you wanna just like mention real quick like what all of that, where it came from, and sort of what is the dynamic and like,
yeah. So here we'll open up here.
Love the train station. And also like this game is so jam-packed with like art and music. How do these things come together and where did they come from?
The music was kicking around and I'd always wanted to find a vehicle to put the music in. This it kind of started as an extension of the sort of musical stuff I was doing and continue to do, but I'm a lifelong gamer, and I one thing led to another, and then once I realized I could sort of say the things I wanted to say beyond music with imagery and juxtaposition, I don't know, I kind of just went hog wild.
That's not creepy.
I can't really tell, but that's okay. So yeah, this is a lot of this is like found art or advertisements for beer or actual board games that I scanned in. And like this is just stuff from my life, like that I like, that made me feel good or interesting. It was like trying to capture a feeling, like a collage or a mixtape. I like the idea of there being like a kind of hybrid station, aquarium, natural history museum.
Yeah.
Like it's like this melange of everything.
Strange art exhibit.
And it's also open. Like I really wanted to make a game that was complete, like that let the player kind of choose their own way through it and have a lot of flow back into itself. Like you kind of meant to do figure eights around the space.
Do you have a favorite area in this game?
Yes, I do. And I'll go there. So these are real pizzas that I either took pictures of that I would end up eating in real life, or just found really good pizza spots.
Wait,
in
he's
New York.
Gonna be mad at you for eating all his pizza. Why did you do that? Why would you do that, man?
I don't know.
Oh, he's in a good mood.
Yeah.
So were you more like into music and then thought like I want to make a video game based on my music and then taught yourself how to make video games, or was it, or like how did that work?
Yeah, I was writing music. I was working for a company that made music for ads, and so that kind of gets to the political thing you were mentioning. Like, and I was just like, you know, So about 3 years ago, I was holed up with an injury. I got hit by a car, actually. I was crossing the street in Williamsburg, and a car came around the corner, and it gave me a lot of time off for about 4 or 5 weeks, and then a little bit later than that. And in that time that I had to kind of like take a minute and like reflect and reassess, I was convalescing, and I realized, hey, I've always wanted to try learning Unity, or use, you know, this tool's been kicking around. It's becoming accessible, and I one thing led to another there, and I started making some basic levels, basic designs, and and by the time I was ready to work again, I was like, oh man, I got this whole other thing I want to do too, and here I am.
Nice.
But I don't know, maybe I would have gotten into it anyway, eventually. But like, I kind of needed that time, I needed that space to try it. So as you see, there's a lot of like records here. These are like real records. My buddy, this is like his actual record collection. And you know, I love the idea of like vinyl culture and having objects that represent music that themselves are a form of currency. Like, vinyl is like board games. Like, there's only a limited amount of it. And then you buy it, and then it's gone. And then maybe it inflates in value. So one of the things all these characters in this train station are alluding to is the fact that the musicians in the space and the artists are kind of all gone, or they've been marginalized.
Yeah. There's sort of like this afterlife of the object of art as a consumer product,
right?
That's going on a lot.
Yeah, and so for example, this is an actual etude book. I started as a cello player from when I was very young. This is an actual etude book I studied out of, and it's like, okay, now it's on display for sale, and the people who are buying it are these like commuter types who are like, ooh, I want to see that. It's like a luxury item. Like a relic luxury item you get. Very difficult etude book. Wouldn't recommend it.
Ooh, can you go to the like dark stairwell of
right. Earth? Yeah, sure. Yeah, so
that's like the zone that I remember the most from this game.
Yeah. So
personally.
So you're in the station, you're finding the tickets. We'll duck into the bar just to see the people there chilling.
Yeah, and the like conversation between like art and music and games.
Yeah.
In this is just so rich and like flavorful, I find. And the stuff that they talk about is also pretty funny.
Yeah. So like in a way, this is, you could look at this in two ways. One way is that it's like an adventure. It's a first-person adventure game with a fairly straightforward mechanic of finding these ticket pieces and eating things and poking things. But then I feel like there's this other level where it almost works as an ambient kind of twine-esque game, where just by like reading these conversations, the ambient in-the-world conversations, you learn the motivations of all the people, and they like paint the picture of this space. It's kind of quasi-dystopian. They're all talking about like their lot in life a little bit, or they're looking for something, or they're after something. Or, you know, and these are big people. They're like the scale. I like right. kind of playing with the scale.
Yeah. They're like giants, kind of.
Yeah. A lot of these are old Polish film posters from the mid-century that I kind of decontextualized and just...
Wait, and if you... The floor is, like, mesh, right?
Yeah. Yeah, you can see through it.
So good.
I think this one's for Alien.
Oh, whoa, really?
Yeah, that was a Polish version of the Alien movie, I think.
Maybe.
All right, so we got a little romance going on here, a little discreet... Makeout session. Berg, Wojciech is a great kind of classic piece of modern classical opera. Really unsettling.
Are those like models of all the NPCs? Are those like, did you find those online or were you making those yourself?
I made them in a piece of software called Fuse, which is now an Adobe product. And it's kind of like a fancy RPG character designer that lets you do a lot of customization of the clothing and the faces and stuff. I kind of just stretched it as much as I could. I didn't really mind that the people looked the way they did. I kind of embraced it.
I think it adds to it because they kind of look a little bizarre, which is perfect.
It's a little uncanny.
Yeah.
But it's good. It's perfect.
So this is kind of looking at the station from a different point of view. I like the idea of okay, now we're, you know, it's the same space, but a little bit of vertigo inducing. And I think Grand Central, you can walk through the windows.
And it feels like liminal, and it's like this separated space from below where you learn about this character. It's mm-hmm. sort of mysterious. I don't mm-hmm. know. I find a lot of like little thematic things in this.
I'll just get to the moment that occurs, and then I'll switch over to NORWOOD SUITE. So
are those just like Unity halos above the like lights?
So we return to the station. So that's online. It's on itch.io and Game Jolt. It's a free game. You can play it at your leisure. Thank you. So that's the game that I did. I released that in 2015. That was the first. I guess it was the first thing I released as a game, and I decided to just straight up follow it up and expand on a lot of the concepts and themes. And so you're going to start to see where I'm going with the follow-up in terms of an expanse of the gameplay, an expanse of the emotional content. We'll see. And it's very much middle of project right now, but... I like where it's evolving. Cool. Especially when it loads.
It'll
take its time. Does anybody have any questions? Anything specific?
What's your sort of plan to roll out the full game, or is there a plan? Or are you kind of just like feeling it out?
I'm thinking 6 months out.
Cool.
But I know that these things take the time they need to take, and. Yeah. If I do push it back, it'll be for the right reasons. I want to really make sure everything about this is settled and solid. So here's where it's at so far. So where the NORWOOD SUITE was set in a train station. This is set kind of upstate, you know, up the river, up to, you know, the same fictional universe. You see the city from a distance. We'll just walk around a little bit in here. Crank it up a little bit.
Is this all of your audio design as well? Or?
Yeah.
What is this called?
The Norwood Suite. So our friend returns. I might swap him out. We'll see.
I kind of like Luke.
Yeah. So he's giving you sort of the main goal of arriving at the space. There's a party in the basement. He wants you to take this demo CD up there. Kind of like your game, how it's like you're kind of trying to do these odd jobs for people. And
you're sort of just like thrust into it.
Yeah.
I got the sense.
Exactly.
Is his thumb really like strange looking for a specific reason, or is that like part of his character?
It's part of it, yeah. I mean, he's been doing a lot of thumb exercise.
So he can play the pedal steel better.
If anybody knows what happens at the end of Off Peak, you might get the detail here.
Oh.
Oh, just
see ya.
There he goes.
So I'm trying to reinforce the mission here, but I'm still tweaking how to best do that.
That seems good, because especially if it's just like reiterating.
Yeah. Okay, so another thing about this game that I'm doing that's different from my last game is I'm trying to make all the music in-game, trying to do it all diegetically. So this place, the Norwood Hotel, it was the mansion. It belonged to a kind of a famous at the time piano player who vanished. And he put all these like sound installations around his grounds, and they all emanate music. So that's kind of my way of getting the music into the world. So
I like
it. Oh, their faces.
Oh, wow. Gorgeous.
Nice volumetric lighting.
Yeah, how did you...
That's not easy to do.
It's a. I think I got it on GitHub. It was a GitHub plugin.
Nice.
Really?
Yeah, so this is another, you know, trying to take the method of, acquiring items, but a step further, so you actually have inventory.
Big fan of backpacks and games.
Cyclist helmet. This is the CD. You can click on it. It becomes your cursor.
Like,
you know, the old missed cursor change. Here we have another. So yeah, here we have another sound installation. So that the speakers are actually responding to the waveform. So it's a way of visually indicating that it's the music is pulsating.
Nice. Are you screwing with the scale?
A little bit. Yeah, the Z scale. So this is different too.
Do they have like little voices?
Yes. And you can eavesdrop on their conversations. They respond to you when you approach them. And you're like listening to them talking, kind of like an off-peak, like they're revealing bits about the world and about themselves and about their motivations for being there. Then you can kind of move around. I think I don't know if I'm projecting in stereo, so if the audio's weird. Thank you for your patience on that.
Oh, so you can give him a helmet?
Yeah, so you
can... Are they unicyclists?
Yeah, they're It's a dangerous sport, but they go for it.
Yeah, no.
So yeah, here's Hans's helmet.
I wonder if they have some connection to that mysterious circus from off peak.
So yeah, the each of the characters, now the text is appearing sort of word by word to help engage more players in what they're saying, and each word has like a sound associated with it, or a pool of sounds. And those sounds are actually musical instruments that I've cut up, that like pieces of musical instruments. So, and they're in tune with the music that's being played. So you'll hear more of that as I continue to explore the space. So it's like it's kind of going back to my musical roots. This is again like a more kind of analog feedback, inspired by, like, I was playing Soma and Amnesia, like, pulling things where the mouse, like, you actually pull the mouse and then, boom, it opens up. A little bit of being able to observe things, just an old friend. Some doors need keys. Let's get a key. So this is kind of like teaching the game systems up front, and it's a process. I still wanna get just so here, take an apple, the rabbit talisman.
I just want to say, I love how your games are so much about, like, physically exploring music.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, that's something that games can do not easily, but so eloquently.
Thank you.
And, like, it really comes together. It's so fresh.
See the radio over here, his voice. I think he's like a steel guitar.
So can you steal stuff in this game too?
Yeah, I mean, you can take everything, and if you present things to people, they'll react to those things. So it's like, if you want to dig deep into how people respond to whatever items you're carrying or anything, you can present it, and they'll say something about it. Who are these people? You may notice the blue suits. It's a through line from off. So we'll get ourselves into the lobby. This, again, this space is another fully explorable space, and though it is a hotel, there is a certain amount of, you know, there are doors you can't enter, and there are spaces you can't reach at first. But for the most part, it encourages that us. I'm aiming for a similar flowing through the space.
Getting a slightly Twin Peaks-y vibe, maybe.
This is Norwood.
Yeah.
Are all these sound effects kind of being generated on the fly, or are they pre-recorded, all those dialogue ones?
They're all generated, like it's from a pool, kind of randomly chosen from a pool.
Sure.
These are two, one is a Farfisa organ, and the other is a Hammond B3 organ. So it's like, that's their like family, the organ family.
I have a picture of one online. I don't, but.
And it's like a way of showing a little bit about them through whatever instrument is represented in their voice. This was inspired actually specifically by the game Killer 7 and just games in general that use sort of a generative text and a little bit like ransom notes, like that's cut up style. This is proprietor through. And so, yeah, you'll move through this space. You'll learn about what these people want. You'll find items, and ultimately, you'll make your way to the basement here. Let's see what it looks like.
I love that, like, the barrier to entry is like not like an expensive like ticket or an invitation. It's like you need a costume.
Yeah, and you got to assemble it, kind of like the way you assemble the ticket. It's a similar like open.
It's like a neat little way to like force bears to get around the space.
Mm-hmm.
And you made this all in Unity.
Yeah.
Because it kind of reminds me of like. Of like Source Engine mods or something, like the way the hallways look and everything like that. It doesn't really look like most Unity games. I just thought that was interesting.
Yeah. Are you using any plugins or?
Yeah, I mean, I'm kind of using whatever it takes to get what I want to have in RAID. So one thing I'll say about this is like the theater room. I want to have this piano be actually playable. I have the script in place, but I haven't implemented it yet. Show you guys one or two more things, and then we'll move on. So this being a hotel, there's a lot of stuff you can kind of just do in hotels. And one of the things you can do is go to the kitchen and make some food. And so I wanted there to be a bit of like ambient stuff, and it's plot specific, but I also want players to feel like they've discovered it. So here we have this set of ingredients: pretzel bun. We have that
complex food crafting system.
Yeah, this is a bit of a nod to the Job Simulator. I was thinking about this when I saw that talk. So that's a thing that's gonna happen.
Oh my god.
Imagine there's like sound effects, and lo and behold.
So it squished there.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Yeah, yeah. You get a tomato. And like all these, the ovens are openable, so I'm gonna put some stuff in there.
Those are the shiniest ovens I've
yeah, noticed. They're very well polished ovens. Let's close it out with.
Start of the show.
Open this. There'll be some assorted things in here. Some lettuce. There we go. So then put that there. Put that there. And finally we have ourselves the pretzel bun turkey sandwich.
Would it have been a sandwich if you just put like lettuce in there?
Yeah.
Or it would have.
Yeah.
As long as you like put the pretzel bun on top.
Yeah. So here's some musicians. They're here on a tour, so you'll learn about their story. And
it's so luxe.
Show you a little bit of the library.
The Buffest library.
Playing some games.
Is that a real game? I ask because like they were playing like Netrunner and the
This is a fictional game. Okay. I'm trying to move away from actual IPs and try to create more of my own.
It's possible.
Yeah.
And so these are all the rooms, and behind each room there's like some sound that tells a little story.
So we're just sort of assuming that there's probably like some farm animals in there and like maybe mice and other. And I don't. A driving test?
It's open to interpretation. So we'll end here in this room because it's open. This is someone's room. I gotta texture those bottles, but.
Kind of look like a Nuka-Cola Quantum or something.
Yeah. Just a little bit of environmental. Looking out. Tennis court. And finally, the personal quarters. I'm going to have it so you can let this creature free. Right now it's just swimming. But this is a taste. This is kind of setting the scene for the adventures and the explorations you're going to have in this game. So
I'm ready.
That's the Norwood Suite so far. Thank you for looking at it.
Thank you for sharing.
Some good stuff.
Any questions, comments, or concerns? Yes. Both open, but
it's quite clever.
Yes. It's intentional. I feel like it's kind of like off-peak in that I want to put a lot of things together that I like and that make me feel a certain way and that make me feel like, ooh, that's interesting, or oh. But it's also the nature of the hotel. Like, the hotel is a place where a lot of different stuff kind of comes together and people come together. So it's like a canvas to do a lot of different things. And one thing I want to do is have this be like the hub setting for future narratives and future games. Like, this, everything kind of revolves around this space. It's like a kind of dimensional locus. Yeah, it's like a crossroads
and art and sort
of different people, different ideas, different motivations, and there's some conflict and there's some turf war stuff going on. So
yeah.
I
think we should have some time at the end of the session to ask everybody questions.
Cool. Let's go ahead and take a look at Lil Bob.
Yeah. I think I'll just...
3, 2, 1. Cover your ears.
Can we swing that?
Let's get Greg, can you, or somebody, can we scoot all the mics over?
Yeah, we can, like... Oh, thanks. Whatever makes sense. We can share this one.
Well, God. Yeah, it's got an HDMI. I'm not sure if the audio will come through the HDMI or if I've got to do it through the...
The audio is through the mini jack, so you need to set it to the headphone output. And Joshua's
okay, so
going to go adjust the projector, so we'll have that back
on. That wasn't
on
bad
in just
at all. Okay, so first of all, thank you so much for having me on this block because I thought I had signed up on Slack and I didn't, and that was totally my fault. And Wiley came up and said, hey, do you want to talk? And I was like, actually, yes. So thank you so much for sharing your time with me. I'm really excited to share some stuff. I think Jamie wanted to say, like... Okay, well, we're Buddy System, Jamie and I, and we have Little Bug here.
We're based out of LA, I guess. That's
yeah.
It's just us two.
Yeah, we drove over here with our cabinet that we have over in the arcade. But before I show Little Bug, because all my games are pretty linear, Little Bug is the first game I started making, and I kind of just, like, downloaded Unity and was like, I want to make a game where you walk left to right, and it's really pretty, and it reminds me of being in the mountains, and Little Bug sort of just, like, mutated out of that. But while I was making Little Bug, I also put together a couple little games, and they're super short and small, so I wanted to just share, like, two of those with you. So I think they're living in fantastic presentation here.
You got your the HDMI plugged in?
Oh, shit. Maybe.
There we go, I bet. There we go.
Cool. Okay, cool.
And thank you to Josh Fields, who just spider monkey climbed all the way up to the projector while we weren't looking to fix that.
All right, let me arrange this. Actually, can I steal this?
Yeah, Xbox absolutely. Controller?
Cool. So I think I've programmed all of these little games to work with. I'm a fan of Buffy, so that's that background. Okay. Let's see. No, those are not the games. Okay, so this game was a game that I made with my girlfriend, who's a digital painter. Let's see. I'm gonna hope that the audio doesn't blow everybody away. Does that sound good? So this is just like a, never mind about the controller working, because it definitely doesn't. So basically, California is going through like a pretty massive drought. So I wanted to like sort of have a game that hinted on that a little bit, because this is to me kind of like what happens in my dreams when I think about what happened if there was 5 more years of drought. And so this is basically just like a Unity terrain with just like some really basic textures on it. And in LA, you'll find lots of, a lot of like lawns for some reason that are like super green, and nobody's really figured out that you can like just put cactuses there. So that's that. And sprinklers seem to just be like constantly on and running into the street. So Floppy Disco is the name of my girlfriend's kind of like online painting blog. So the deal with this game is just basically you walk up to these paintings, and when you look at them, they'll become unobscured and the water will stop pouring in. But if you don't look at them, the water level slowly begins to rise. And that, the initial sound of the water turning on was actually my shower, like that I recorded, because every morning my roommate wakes up and just like basically has like a, I don't know what he's doing in there, like some sort of like water ritual or something, but like there's just tons of shit going on at the same time, like a toilet flushing, then like the showers on, and then like I hear like the faucet turn on, and it's just like I don't know what's going on. So this is just me being like, instead of confronting him about that, I'm gonna make just like a passive aggressive game that's like art also, I guess. So the water level is moving up pretty fast, and when it gets to you, it'll actually kill you. So that's definitely something that would never happen in LA, being killed by water. But yeah, and they're sharing the same shader, so they're all kind of like, this is when I was kind of like not the best at programming, so they're all kind of doing that at the same time. Yeah, so in the end, the only thing you really can do is just, you know, die. So we're just gonna walk up here and take one last look. This is Hana's music, my girlfriend. She made this. And then it kind of just ends there. And then it starts over, so I'm just gonna press. So that was like a really early game that I made while developing Little Bug. But then there was just one more that I wanted to share with you before. So like, I got asked to do programming for some like random company in LA. And I was like, cool, but like I work as a butcher, which is true, I did at the time. And I was like, I don't really know how to program. They're like, just do like a clone of Breakout and send it to us and we'll look at your source code. And I was like, cool, so I made it in like 2 days and then they never got back to me. So I was like, I'm gonna skip the new version. So I was just like, yeah, you're not gonna take that time away from me. And I basically just reskinned it. I think it's already on this. So I basically just reskinned Breakout and turned it into like a, it is maximized. Yeah, the nips, we'll get there. So this game is basically just like my attempt at making a personal game that is, I have psoriasis. I was also going through sort of some like self-worth and self-image stuff. So it's kind of the perfect time getting rejected from this job to be like, I think I'll make a game where I reflect that with zits, and it was Breakout, so I just decided to call Breaking Out. I think this has sound too, but. Okay, so we actually have over here, I think it's called Claritin or Clarisol or something, the stuff you put on your face to like, yeah, so then you just like, we'll pop these. I never actually put this online for probably obvious reasons, but like, I just was like, I don't know how comfortable I am. Because later levels, there's like one on my back, one of, I think you might have seen it, said nips. And then there's one on my face. But I'll probably just play this level just to show you kind of like the gist of how this works. But yeah, I just was like, I'm not about to do all that work and like let you not hire me and not actually do something, so. Okay, I'll just play the face level real quick, but.
Oh, no.
So basically you're just like helping somebody with their self, with like their, I guess like, body issue by just like popping their zits for them. But it's me, so that's a secret. Oh no, that was not what I meant to do. Sorry, everybody. Ooh, mad combo. Watch this. Oh, never mind. I lost the combo. Yeah, so that's Breaking Out.
Nice.
So yeah, very much like Little Bug, not at all. But so I think, without further ado, Jamie is going to do a speed run of Little Bug really quick, and I think she's going to. I don't know if anybody's played it yet, but. It is very hard to not die. And Jamie,
what?
You're going to not die, right?
No.
Okay.
I'm going to die probably at least once. Is the controller working?
Yeah, I think the controller's working, so.
Cool.
Let's see. There it is. Sorry, my screen got really small when I plugged in the HDMI. I can barely see anything. And I think we want to do something like this resolution, or it might run a little slow. There you go, Jamie.
Thank you.
I'll turn it down a little bit. Yeah, so the music is done by my friend Seth in Oakland, and we used to be in a band together, and she knew I was doing a video game, and she was like, I want to get in on that, and I was like, really? really flattered because I thought she would hate it. Okay, so it's actually being really choppy, so I'm going to turn the resolution down even more. Yeah, the resolution is just, I don't know what's going on, but it could be that I have, that I'm playing this game on a Mac and it's not really the best. Yeah, it's not super choppy, it'll be fine. So yeah, basically, your little girl, kind of like lost in the woods, and you're looking for your mom. Sorry, I thought I was gonna be so much more like eloquent when I came up here. Like, here's all this deep stuff about this game, and there definitely is. Like, I spent a lot of time just getting to this point, using these weird sort of controls and having these two characters that you play with yourself, basically. Like, I've called it self-co-op when people have asked. You can definitely play local co-op, but it's not really intended for that. And originally, it was just like a walking simulator where you just walk left to right in slow motion, and there was just like pretty music playing in the background. And I playtested it with some people, and they were like, so when do I get to play the game, though? And I was like, it's a walking sim? And I was just like, you're right. So I like, definitely wanted areas like this where it's like pretty and you get that sense of space and you get that sense of isolation and you get that sense of play where you can just be like jumping around and just like being in the forest. Yeah, I think Jamie wants to say something.
So the mechanic, well, I actually met Bella on Craigslist. He was like, I'm looking for people in LA to work with on games. And he showed me this, like we met up at some bar where after he like got off of his job at the Butcher's, so it's like downtown. Oh yeah, sure. The mechanic is what drew me. Well, the art too, but the mechanic's kind of like, it's kind of like a grappling hook, and like sort of jumping around like you're Spider-Man. So I don't know if any of you played it in the arcade, but it's fun to play with twin sticks. And I think that's why I was like, yeah, I'll work on this.
Yeah, okay, so now we'll just keep passing it back and forth. So that jar there is, like, really... I like the idea of backpacks in games, too, but I also hate them because I've just, like... Like, I love games like, I guess, like, Skyrim and stuff where you can walk around and collect things, but I hate using them. Like, I hate it. I hate how you need to, like, oh, here comes this thing, so now I've got to pull out that really badass sword, but I can't use it for too long because or else it'll get, like, damaged, so I got to pull out my crappy thing afterwards. And I was just like, I want to have that sort of collection that you can do, and that sort of like prettiness of, so I kind of combine that with like a checkpoint mechanism where, yeah. So Iman is a friend of mine, and when she first playtested this game, she loved the character and really wanted to be involved as like the main character. Literally, she wanted to be the main character. So I based it off of her, and I basically asked her. She's a PhD studying mushrooms.
She's super cool.
And so that's why we based our game on. But I was like, so
yeah, this is like kind of like a tiny scientist collecting stuff for research.
Yeah, it's kind of like I mean, there's more to like a full story that's going on here. But like, I just basically asked her like, what would you put in your jar? And if you were walking through the forest, like, what would be the things that you'd pick up? And she started talking to me about how there's mushrooms that are like microscopic, and there's bones, and there's everything has a little story, and if you just look down, you'll be able to see it, but most people don't, they just step on them instead. So, definitely never really got to the point where we were able to like flesh out that full story there, but I still wanted to really include that look and that feel and like what she was talking about, and just represent it in a way that could kind of leave it up to the player to decide what that stuff was and what it's for. And kind of have these like vague quotes that she says. So yeah, they are, this is where it gets really hard, and I don't know.
So one thing that's in this game is that both a firefly and a girl can get hurt.
Yeah.
You kind of need, they're like working together. It's like you're controlling two characters and they need each other to get through. So
yeah.
It's like, so they, yeah, basically they can both get hurt.
Okay, so. Yeah, so Jamie wants to try hard to get here. Okay, so so yeah, and we've released the game online in May, and like I was just kind of working on this as like can I make a video game? Yes, yes or no. And I gave myself a year, and this is like the product of that year of just like downloading Unity and learning programming and just kind of figuring it out. And also, I'd never really modeled anything in 3D before, although I'd done like interactive sculpture and stuff in school. So I really wanted to.
It's an amethyst.
That's an amethyst. Kind of, I mean, people have been kind of getting. Iman likes amethyst, yeah. But I also really love 2D art. I mean, I grew up on Nickelodeon. I grew up on Cartoon Network. Like, I've had a sketchbook my whole life, and I didn't want that to be absent from this story. So that's why you see a lot of these like hands and these tears and these creepy eyeballs. Like, it's just basically like bringing my sort of sketchbook world into like a playable format in a sense, but also kind of trying to tell a real story about this kid and about her mom. And the demo kind of hints at it because, to be honest, we didn't really have a super clear idea of what that story was, and we needed to just push a game out. So we left a lot of cliffhangers and open ends to let people sort of come to a conclusion while we were figuring it out.
These are Lycan.
Yeah, these are Lycan, and so like Iman said that lichens are little fungus cities of bacteria and fungus that are like working together, and they have like a little happy family. So I really like that. I want to put
so
that
you guys
there.
Said that the jar is connected to like a checkpoint system.
Yes.
How does that work?
Well, basically, so it's like, aesthetic.
Yeah. So like where I picked it up there, I can get I can end myself, and then I'll respawn where.
Yeah, and you can open the jar and look at the stuff in it. A lot of people will play without opening the jar at all, but it'll still save your position. So the jar is just one of those extra things where, like, if you want to take the time to open it and look at it and sort of, it's there. And like, in a theoretical full game, which we really want to do, but it's going to be a lot of work, we'd like to really have that jar. Nice. We'd like to have that jar be more of like a living environment that kind of grows and dies over time, and you'll be able to sort of like grow more things out of the decay of the stuff that's growing and dying inside of it. But this is really a proof of concept that I just polished a lot just so that I could see how far I could take some polish with it still being like, you know, make it pretty with minimal effort. And there's your friend. So yeah, that's the game, and that character actually, when we've been seeing people do Let's Plays online after they've downloaded from itch.io and GameJolt and stuff, is like a lot of people will see that character and think that it's like a boss, which is exactly what I wanted. But actually, like, that character ends up being a very close companion throughout the story, and you actually lose your Firefly at the end, and you're supposed to play basically the next leg of the story only with that character. And that character is actually tormented by those pink hands, and they are kind of like in this sort of spirit battle, and then you're kind of stuck in the middle of it. So that was really important, making this game, is just like, what's a gamer's expectation out of a platformer, and let's try and kind of like upset that and push the story while we do it at the same time. And there's a lot more to go along with that, but that's kind of like the sort of overall gist of like what I was trying to do around every turn with this game design.
Just really quickly, the credit screen just popped up, but our collaborators are, okay, well, Seb did the music, Iman helped us with concept and story, and then we hired a new writer, Bianna Davis, I think her Twitter is at Yana Hollows, to write. We have now a full story that we can base the full build on.
Yeah, so exactly.
In the middle of concepting that.
Yeah, I mean, like, this first game was mostly, like, me in my bedroom, and then, which is kind of why the opening screen is that, too, because, like, I just wanted it to be really personal, but also, like, be a story, because, like, a lot of it is about me and about, like, running around in the wilderness as a kid and wanting to fly and stuff like that, but...
Do you guys have plans for the future for this game?
Yeah, I mean, we're working on, figure out when we can do the full build, but it'd probably be like a year of production.
Yeah.
We really want to extend it out. This is like sort of like a demo first chapter, but then we'll do like 3 to 5 chapters. We also have a versus mode that's pretty funny that we...
Yeah, we actually showed our game at Evo.
We showed it at Evo. Like, two little girls zapping each other. It's really funny.
Yeah, and people... and we had these like sort of like hardcore like fighting game, like Tekken guys coming over, and they were like, yeah, and then they started playing it and they just like wouldn't put the controller down. I was like, okay, yeah, like
as soon
I guess
as they said, it's like your Spider-Man, they're like, oh, I can't.
They're like, whoa, yeah. So so yeah, we have plans to roll out stuff like that, but I mean, this is me and Jamie's, like, this is our first time putting a game out and like taking it around to festivals and doing any of this, like, so we're kind of, you know, like talking with people, seeing what like the best options are, but we would really love to make that full game, and it's we have a lot planned, so yeah, that's in short kind of what's going on.
How are we doing on time?
Actually, still we're doing pretty well on time. If you guys want to open it up to questions, or if you have more stuff you want to show.
I think Bella's gonna show a little bit.
Sure. I mean,
or I can just do my little art thingy.
Yeah, I think Jamie, I think we have a couple things in here that Jamie wanted to show.
Okay.
Like, because Jamie, our background is kind of weird. Like, we like we have a background in zines and music
comics,
and basically not video games at all.
Yeah,
so and so this was...
We approached our collaboration as sort of like a zinester might, just like open collaboration going back and forth.
But do you want, you want to do this? Okay,
yeah.
Cool.
Okay. So I wanted to go over process because I like, in comics, process talk is always... my favorite, but...
Jamie, can you get up on your mic a little
bit? Oh, yeah, sure. Hello. So I'm going to read from our devlog. We actually started another game. Oh, wait. Where's the gifts?
Okay, I can actually show the gifts for
the
game.
Yeah, the gifts for the game will be... Is it in...
I think it's all in here, I think.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Or no, it's on. It's on the
on
internet.
The internet. So we have to get into the internet. Oh.
Oh, this is Booba Zone.
So this is our...
This
basically
is not,
our core
this
influence.
This is not our game, but this is our core influence. I don't know if anybody's
Danny
played this.
Dan Rickert,
I
but this is
thing.
Our favorite game to go back to. We'll never make anything as good as this.
You can add tracks.
Yeah, highly recommend it. I'm at 5 stars.
I think there should be a free play at Fantastic Arcade at some point, but anyway, there's
a
lot of
great
games in there.
Yeah,
so,
so this is the other game that we, like, halfway through Little Bug, Bella was like, I'm sick of looking at this game, so let's make another game. It'll be way easier. To make this game is not easier.
It definitely wasn't easier.
Same amount of hard.
That was like me being like, I've never made a video game before mentality. But
yeah, this game's based off like buoyancy. And I'm going to talk about, or I'm going to just read from the devlog from when we were making this game so you get an idea of how we work together. So January 24th, 2016, modeled breakfast stuff, plate, bacon, egg. January 23, 2016. There was an invalid AABB bug in Unity, and I sat around and speculated how Bella should fix it. As it turned out, we just needed the newest patch of Unity, 5.3.1 before. And then I like to log like what we ate and drank, drank and listen, like musically listened to that day.
Oh God.
Because we always had music playing.
Can't wait for that.
Yeah, so anyway, number two, this is two on that list. I ate tofu. I think we are going to make a table/breakfast scene now. Number three is just a bunch of music. Molly Nelson, Cigarettes After Sex, I Heart My Art, and some Robots in Disguise, I guess?
Yeah.
Okay.
We just have lots of like food on our mind, I guess.
And number four, modeled a single serving cream packet and mug. Some initial puzzle designs. January 9th, 2016, Bella dubbed the Sugar Cube gameplay, including the special glitter cube and bombs in me to explode. Number two, Jamie mostly did nothing. It was her birthday. I don't know why I switched a third person there. Played Netrunner with Mark, Smash Up with Hana. Also, we had quesadillas and corn on the cob and champagne. That was my birthday. And then I actually did work after that. Level design, concept art, underwater, showcasing ideas for depth.
That's my dog.
Octopus, tentacle grabs, you at the bottom, overwater with beverage cheese service props. End of game, shore made of two oversized hands carrying. But yeah. So our process is basically
thank
like
you for that, Jamie.
Bella starts with like a mechanic that he's excited about in Unity. In Little Bug, it was like the connecty beam, and then for Submarina, it was don't look at the other stuff. Just those two cards of these. Submarina. Oh,
this
these
is beautiful
these are
art
concept,
that Jamie
these are
did.
Concepts for
I
Little
really
Bug.
Like it.
Concepts for Little Bug, but yeah, and then we talk about like. Oh, you should zoom into that, because then you can scroll, and you can see the story of the visual
script. I'll scroll for you.
Yeah. Yeah, you can explain that, too. But yeah, we, and then we'll talk about, like, what the characters
so
are.
Could this is for Little Bug, right?
Yeah, this is Little Bug.
Yeah, this is sorry, we're kind of like jumping around, but.
But yeah, so from the mechanic, then we can talk about what the who the characters are, based on like how they move together, and then we talk about like a level, and then Bella does level design. And
then we get our friends drunk, and then we have a big dinner party
where everyone play tests and we fix the game.
It's really professional.
that's social hang. Sort of our process.
Development hang. Yeah.
Well, also, like, drunk people will say stuff that's on their mind, like, for real, which is great. Also, little kids do, too.
Okay, so I guess the bridge. Okay. This is sort of, like, how I try. I come from, like, an animation-y background, so I tried to help Bella do some level design. I don't know if I really helped very much, but it's like a storyboard.
It helps. Yeah. I mean, like, that's definitely in the game at some point.
Yeah, at the beginning of Little Bug, we were like, she has to be in danger at some point, and then the Firefly shows up. So that's mostly, I think that's everything.
I think that's basically everything. Like, yeah, this game went through a lot of, like, weird iterations. Like, this is, like, the original, this is, like, the original art for it. Or, like, this is the first level I ever made. And that's all you could do, though, is you could basically just stand on that island, and nothing else happened. Nice. But it was pretty, and that's what I was going for, so. Yeah. I mean, yeah, that's pretty much it. That's another sort of early iteration. This is what she originally looked like. And people are like, why does she have, like, a weird sweater on?
That is a weird sweater.
Yeah, I don't know. I was learning. So, yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's what we did in a nutshell. Yeah.
And you can get the demo for Little Bug is on GameJolt.itch.io.
Yeah.
And our website is buddysystem.la.
Yeah, and the demo is free for Mac and Windows.
Yeah, demo's free.
Cool.
Yeah,
I think that is it.
We've got plenty of time for questions. If you guys have any more questions for each other, I think that's really cool.
Yeah.
Or
I also have like more, I guess, like random bonus content that I could show. I don't know if you have any other stuff that you would be.
I was going to show how I did the voices in Norwood Suite.
Yeah,
that'd be cool. I think bonus content's great.
Okay, cool. I need to plug my laptop in.
Okay.
I'm in a similar situation.
Let's do you first, and then...
Here's the HDMI.
Great.
Maybe we can do like questions from the audience while we do the bonus content or something.
Yeah, Lance, do you have a question?
Yeah, I don't know if anybody has questions. I can't see.
Can you see me?
Yeah, I can see you.
Okay.
Oh, sure.
So from what I can tell, your game just basically has you controlling like two people or two beings at the same time to like maneuver through the game. Mm-hmm. Like, have you had like a basis on like split mind gaming or anything like that?
Can
do you know what he's talking about? Like,
yeah. Can you explain split mind to me? Soft body. I have actually seen videos, but I have no idea what's going on in that game. Soft body.
What I mean by split mind, like stuff, like.
Oh, I know what you're talking about.
She knows.
Yes.
Do you want to?
Okay. Yeah. It's like, basically, the two halves of your brain, they do different things, and one is speaking, and one side's not speaking, and so there's this like, if you study them, for people who have their brain had been disconnected down the middle. They'll have separate thoughts at the same time. It's kind of like you have a second person inside your brain. Pretty nuts. There's a YouTube video. I think it's CCBP Gray. It is really awesome.
Wow, so you know like everything about this, not just like...
Oh, it's super rad.
How has this never come up?
No, but I think we didn't think about that in the game, but that's super interesting that you bring it up. And
people have definitely said that it feels like their brain's being split in half when they play it, so maybe that...
That's a great question, actually.
Yeah, it wasn't intentional, but yeah, that's a really good question.
Considering, like, you've got, you know, one side is dominant, has dominant control of a hand, if you had that kind of condition and you were sort of playing a two analog stick game like that.
Yeah, that's
interesting.
Are
there any
other
questions from the audience?
I actually have to use the bathroom real quick, so I'll be right back.
Yeah, that's fine.
Bye-bye.
Do we have my screen is plugged into HDMI. I don't know.
Maybe you need to plug it in.
Yeah, I'll try to.
I had to jiggle it on mine a little bit.
Okay.
To work.
And be careful plugging it in and out a lot because sometimes that'll throw the projector off.
Got it.
No, we don't.
But it looks like it's about to come up. Yeah. Cool. There we go.
So,
okay, we have a question here in the middle.
Yeah.
question for the stream was how do the controls work for somebody who hasn't played it yet?
So the controls are really optimized for an Xbox controller or any kind of gamepad, really. You control, it's kind of like FPS, like a first-person shooter controls, but like you're side-scrolling. So you're actually controlling two characters, one with each stick, and then you have one button where you connect them with the beam, and that beam is basically your utility for jumping, for blowing up blocks, for doing all sorts of stuff. So one thing I wanted to do is, like, because it's already complicated enough controlling two characters, I only wanted one action that does everything in the game. And we kind of just, like, touched in that demo, like, touched on, like, what those actions could be, but there's a lot more that we had planned that we weren't able to put in. But yeah, that's kind of how it is. Actually, we have an arcade cabinet in the arcade, and so that's even crazier to use because there's two big sticks that you have to use, and then you use a foot pedal as your action. So if you've ever played the drums before and thought it was, like, blowing your brain up, that's kind of, like, how that feels, too. It wasn't intentional to be, like, super hard. I think it's just kind of how it ended up being.
I think it's, like, learning how to drive. You just have, like, both hands and your foot, or, like, three things going at once.
Yeah.
Or, like, a sewing machine, a lot of people say. Looks like a sewing machine.
Yeah, like a sewing machine, too, because you're, like, using both your hands and a foot pedal at the same time. Yeah. Did you want to take it away? Or?
Yeah, no, I'm just acknowledging that that's... a nice indirect way of teaching life skills.
Video games is learning.
So this is how I did some of the vocal snippets in the Norwood Suite. This is kind of my technique right now. So here we have an alto flute for relaxation. I personally love the alto flute. I think it's a great kind of underused instrument. For those who aren't familiar, it's just a giant flute, and it plays really low, but it sounds like a flute.
Did you write from YouTube on there, so you knew?
Yeah, I just want to make sure I'm getting the right source.
Gotcha.
Okay, so here we have, I think this is from, okay.
Born into a prominent and wealthy family in the city, Plato devoted his life to one goal, helping people to reach a state of what he termed eudaimonia.
So I just needed somebody talking, and that seemed good. So I liked that. So I basically ran, I don't know if you guys have messed around with vocoding. A vocoder basically takes one sound and uses another sound as an envelope. So it's like you have the source of the flute, but it sounds like it's coming out of somebody's face. So I'll see how this works here.
Born into a prominent and wealthy family in the city, Plato devoted his life to one goal, helping people to reach a state of what he termed eudaimonia, or born into a prominent...
So it's like trying to find the balance where it kind of sounds like a voice, but it also kind of sounds like an instrument.
So... Sorry, this is gonna get like Ableton-y for like 1 second, but are you just sidechaining the track into the with like the flute?
Mm-hmm.
Is that what's going on? Didn't know you could do that. That's really
external
cool.
External audio from flute.
Born into a prominent and wealthy family in the city, Plato devoted his life to one goal, helping people to reach a state of what he...
So just kind of massaging it to where I like it, and then mixing in back the original signal. Which is kind of doing the flip, I think. No, it's just gating the flute so that you have a little of that original signal too. So when I feel like I have it where I like it, I take like little snippets of that and I just cut them up to the point where I just get these guys. Let's see. Oh, that's unrelated, but you guys get the idea. So that's the process I'm using. It's I like it because it takes an instrument, it gives it a little bit of humanization, but it keeps it ambiguous. So that's that.
I mean, it definitely gives your game a unique feel for sure as far as sound goes. And are you kind of keeping a similar key in mind so that when there's a lot of sound going on top of each other, like it's not like that dissonant, or is that something you think about?
Yeah. So the keys that are playing in the world, are I try to keep them in the same or in relatively matching keys. There are moments where I have to literally ride the key changes, and I've dealt with that. But yeah, I want to make sure everything is basically in tune, and it's a challenge, but I embrace it, I guess.
Yeah. Well, it's definitely working, so you're doing something right.
Thank you.
Definitely. So do you want to show more stuff, or should I can pull up my bonus content?
Bonus content.
All right.
While James is getting plugged in, there was a question from the Twitch stream for Bella and Jamie. Have you guys considered bringing a little bug to mobile?
That is kind of last on the chopping block for sure. You saw how it was chugging on my laptop at pretty low resolution. So that's going to take a lot of optimization. And it totally could, and I think it'd be really fun, especially because the controls are so strange. I feel like we could find some really interesting ways to make that work on mobile. So I'm definitely excited about it, and I've thought about it. But the amount of optimization that I'd have to do and just like sort of reworking the whole thing and then putting it on mobile is, I don't know, maybe not the first thing that I'm thinking of doing right now, especially when thinking about building the full game.
There was an earlier iteration, too, where the Firefly basically just, the momentum of the Firefly dragged the girl, and there wasn't Twin Stick. It was, remember, there was like one time you had it, so
it was
just the Firefly. So that, and someone asked us about that. We were like,
yeah, you can play the whole game without actually even moving the little girl, to be honest. So
someone asked us about that, and that was the first time we'd ever thought about it.
Yeah.
Like, they were like, oh, that could be really good, so maybe.
So this is the manual that we made for the game, I'm really proud of it. It's full of stuff. This is actually available free. There's a Dropbox link on our itch page, and it's also included in downloadable versions of the game. If you have it on Steam, what you can do, I'll show you real quick in case anyone is curious. If you like, right-click on the game in Steam and go to Properties, and browse your local files, it's actually right here. So like including the manual is something that like I've seen a lot of indies like start to do, and I think especially in terms of like our game, it's like a very confusing motherfucking video game. So having like a manual that like throws you a bone and maybe like gives you some hints and a map. There's a map here.
Wow, cool. Is that like the...
I just want to comment. This reminds me of 90s boxed computer game approach.
Sure.
I love it.
Cloth map that you got.
Yeah, the cloth map.
Yeah. Did this map that we're looking at come before or after building the actual game?
This came literally like night of launch. I was like, hey, Megan, one of the other artists in Sunday Month, like, do you have like an hour to like do some art, and she was like, yeah, and totally into it. So the idea with this is that it's like kind of inaccurate because we wanted players to make their own maps. Of course, someone found like a Gama Sutra article that I wrote like 2 years ago that has like the perfect map and like ripped the image from that. So purpose a little defeated, but
that's dedication though. That's kind of flattering.
Yeah, I'm glad that they did. I'm just like, I really wanted people to like struggle to make a map. Anyway, this is Delvine, one of the goddesses. This is a piece of art that one of our other artists, Brooke, drew, and she did a great job. Delvine is the goddess of like war and traps or something, dungeons. So she's like the queen of the dungeon, and her description is that she is wreathed in many arms holding jewel-encrusted weapons. So I don't know if you notice, but like, she's like got this hood, but it's actually just like limbs.
Yeah. It looks like hair almost, but it's like, that's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah, she did a great job. So this is like the legend for the map. And it sort of tells you what items like are sold and bought in which places. This is some advice on like playing the game and keeping your luck up.
Oh, that's the person who robbed me.
Yeah, one of the guards. And like, yeah, just some like little like flavor text and a little bit about the world, and just like a notes section, which is very important. So that's the
that's really cute.
That's the manual, but there's a lot of other stuff in the bonus content, and I kind of laid it out like similar to the game. So there's these different areas, and you can like go to different places that are named after. Let me see if I can change the view to be like. Okay, cool. This is a little bit better. So like, there's like some GIFs of the game and Windows 10. Yeah. Okay. So like, there's like little snippets, just like a picture of just random screenshots.
Your soundtrack was pretty great. Is that available?
Yeah. So the soundtrack will be available soon. It's in the works. But in here there is a bunch of sound effects from the game, like the player vomiting and the skull yelling at you. The idea is like if you wanted to use it as like a cell phone ringtone or something, it's here.
Obviously.
Or remix it. There's like little snippets. There's a poem in there. And then the really cool things. Oh, so who does this? So this is like a really early version of the game. This is like the earliest build that I could find that is like still recognizably Diaries of a Spaceport Janitor. And it's dated, this is modified because I put it in there. But this is like dated back to September 2014.
Oh yeah, that's that old school Unity Splash.
So this is like super, super old Diaries of a Spaceport Janitor. So these screens are like slightly less intense in the game. They're still there, but the art team hated them when I first put them in. And it was like the whole world was like all blocked out, and I like went to a meeting one day and I was like, hey, yo, I added the coolest thing to the game, look. And they were like, what did you do? You broke this. In this, there's like these orbs that you have to collect, because the idea was that we were testing the environment, because we wanted to see from a very early stage, like the first thing that we did was set up the environment to be to like loop properly. Sort of like how I was saying earlier. There's these objects. Yes.
Did it loop like sort of the classic way originally, where if you went off west, you would return east, or was it always the crazy?
Yeah, no, it's always been the crazy thing. And you know what I could do is show you, probably exactly how. If I go all the way over to the ziggurat.
Is this basically what the level would become? Like, did the structure maintain?
Yeah, so this is the same layout. It actually hasn't changed very much. I even still get lost, especially playing this old version. Yeah, it's extra hard because everything is just, like, Sonic checkers. And there's all these objects. Most of these items are still in the game, and they're either their present or modified state. Sometimes I would like change the colors of art that our trash artist did, and like make it slightly take an object.
Oh,
and
like your artist who made trash, not like your artist.
Yes.
Okay.
Our artist who made trash. No.
Sorry, the inflection on your voice. I was like, ooh, that's.
No, I don't mean to throw shade. All everyone who worked on our game is like incredibly talented.
Yeah. No, that was probably more my end, but.
Okay. So this is the top of the ziggurat, which is like the tallest point in the game, and if you look, you can sort of see yourself.
Whoa! Yeah.
And you can still do this in the final game. It's just not quite as like. Obvious, and I think you can like get up to the very top. So this, you can see what's going on in the world, is that what we're actually at the corner of the map right now, looking out across. So it's a square, and you can see the seams too. And then it's like mirrored four ways. So
this reminds me of the first time I played Portal. I was like, what is happening?
Yeah, so this is like, it becomes more obvious when you're at the top of the ziggurat that like that road is the same as that road is the same as that road over there. You're sort of stuck in this endlessly looping place. And it's like an extended metaphor, I guess, for like being physically trapped in a shitty spot in life.
Gotcha. Because I guess I was going to ask, like, why didn't you just build something that was like that shape?
Yeah, no. And this also lets us like have, first of all, it makes the world feel like 10 times bigger. And it also like lets us have an environment where like, there's no like walls that like block you in, but so it feels super open. There's no way to quit this. You have to alt F4.
I think one thing I've sort of noticed in all of our games is that they all seem to, whatever, you know, because we've all shown several games. One thing I'm thinking about is that like they were ways that we expressed some sort of discontent with something that was going on. It was like a way of letting that out through this. And I don't know if that was Wiley's intention to share the table.
Yeah,
but
you got, I just sensed that you were all
we're all like working through a way to acknowledge our discontents in a way.
Yeah, that's a really great observation.
And
co-signed.
I mean, it's like you gotta.
Let's find out.
Do we have any questions from the audience?
Yeah,
questions.
We've got one in the back on the right.
Oh yeah. Absolutely.
Question for the live stream was treatment of gender in Spaceport Spaceport Janitor. I almost said manager again.
Absolutely. So the gender. Oh, this is just like an early proof of concept where I was just like, how do I make a world loop seamlessly in Unity? In terms of gender. Oh, yeah, there's the edge. In terms of gender, that was something that like we always wanted to be a part of the game. But did not make it in until very late, actually. So for those unfamiliar, basically in the game, I guess I could just like pull it up again. I don't want to get sucked into it. You guys can play it. It's on the laptops. But the way it works is like there's an invisible timer in the game that counts down. It's like 10 minutes or so. And at the end of, or when it gets low enough, the screen starts to get all fuzzy and like warbly, and the status effect tells you that you need to gender shift. And all of the text in the game starts to like shift around and becomes like almost completely illegible. So basically, you can still like sleep and eat and progress in the game. It doesn't actually like do anything, but it makes the game like completely impossible to play unless you fix your dysphoria by going to a gender kiosk and purchasing some gender and eating it. And at that point, yeah, exactly. It spits out a gender that is just pulled from a list of like 20 like ridiculous genders that we came up with, including dirt and photonica, I think is my favorite personally. Also like Swarm Cat and Susan Sarandon is a crowd favorite. So it's like, along with a lot of other things in the game, it's like kind of a like shitty thing in real life, like living with gender dysphoria and like having to spend like a significant amount of a small amount of money that you have like on ways to deal with that, whether it's like clothes or medicine or treatments. But like in the game, we wanted to make it be visually interesting and also like hopefully funny, and not something that people necessarily like get really upset about. Like it's not, like, we're interested in conveying the reality of these experiences, but not, like, just, like, I don't know. We still want it to be, like, pleasant to play. So I think that was hopefully our goal with that, is to, like, do it in a creative way.
We have any other questions?
Oh, sorry. I just want to say I think you did a good job on that.
Yeah, I think that's, like, I think that's also a really huge part of game design in general, is, like, whether it's like a really stale thing like mechanics or whether it's something that means a lot to you or is personal, like you have to make it palatable for people right. So they don't just like drop the controller.
Right.
And so like that's huge. And yeah, you did a good job.
Not to mention, I've always thought it's kind of weird that even in like sci-fi where you've got just tremendous bug aliens, they're like half the time there's like weird binary gender stuff on these ridiculous weird aliens.
Star Trek is a great example.
Yeah.
Oh, there's the sexy lady alien. Great.
Yeah. Oh my god. Okay, wait. So it's mild complete tangent. There's this one episode of Star Trek. I'm a ridiculously huge Star Trek nerd. There's one episode of Next Generation where they go to this planet where there's like androgynous aliens and Riker falls in love with one of them. Yeah. And of course it turns out that she's a female and gender is illegal on this planet. And it's just, like, so tone-deaf and awful, but I love it to pieces. So, like, that maybe was, if not an influence, like, something going around in my head while all of this was coming together. But it's funny, the response that we've gotten to gender specifically, it does tend to be something that people talk about a lot, which isn't something that totally caught me off guard, but, like, it's just funny because it made it into the game so late, and it's a relatively very small part of the game, but I think it adds a lot to the experience, and people are really interested in it. And, like, on Steam, people, like, have not been horrible about it, which is nice. People have been... It seems like they're very interested and open and, like, ready to at least, like, talk about it or, like, be interested in it. And we're not getting a lot of people who are, like... Ew, there's gender in this game.
Right. It's hard to get too grumpy about Susan Sarandon pills.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd probably take those.
Smile.
Yeah, but some people have actually been like, I'm upset that gender doesn't like block me more, that they can just ignore it and like stealth it. But like in real life, like you can just stealth it and ignore the dysphoria. It just sucks. Or some people can, maybe. That's not true for everyone. Sorry, you were going to...
Oh, I was just going to say, it's cool that people are talking about it because that's kind of makes it clear that there's not enough conversation points in the game world where people can talk about it in a good way.
Right.
So I think that that's just shows that your game was like leading the conversation in a positive way, which is cool.
I hope so.
I have a question right here.
Right. For the Twitch stream, the question is, like, maybe the humor aspect of the gender implementation sort of helped it be more, I guess, palatable to people who aren't prepared at all for that conversation. And, like, maybe, probably, I would say, like, the humorous aspect of it is, like, kind of just, like, how at least I personally and definitely other queer people on the team like understand gender. Like, gender is kind of just ridiculous, just fundamentally to us at least. So that just sort of showed through in the game like naturally. It's hopefully funny and maybe takes a little bit of the edge off of potentially really stressful and bad things happening.
And it's the overall tone of the game, right?
Right.
I mean, you're using humor here to deal with, you know, being flat broke,
yeah,
too,
exactly.
Which is a pretty serious
and like,
subject.
With everything in the game, like it's like a shitty thing. Like, you're a janitor, you don't make any money, you get mugged all the time, and, like, you get sick and vomit a lot, but, like, it's all really cute and charming, hopefully, and colorful, so maybe those things sort of offset it. I don't know.
Do you have any additional questions from either the audience or anybody on the Twitch stream? Do you guys have any more questions for each other?
There's a question all the way in the back. Yeah. Little Bug is a complete mess of scripts and Playmaker, oftentimes talking to each other in really terrible ways. For those of you that aren't familiar with Playmaker, it's a visual editing software or plugin that you can use with Unity. And I usually just use Playmaker to do stuff like tweening and like adding sounds and sort of doing... I basically just use Playmaker for coroutines and finite state machines because I'm not a programmer and I didn't teach myself how to do that. But at the same time, I downloaded Playmaker and it was an easy fix. So for all the stuff that's like movement, character movement, physics, like all of that I'm handling in code, in custom code, in scripts. And then Playmaker is handling all like the sort of more like polishy stuff, like when you move over a button or something pops up and it like flickers away. Like that's all handled in Playmaker because it can really easily animate those things with curves visually. And I don't really use the animator that much because I use Playmaker in place of an animator.
I'm going to second that. I also have been using it in my work. And it's a similar like mishmash of the two, the plugins talking to each other and other scripts. I feel like when you come from a medium where you can easily just like make a gesture and it gives you the result very quickly, and you want to do that in a game engine where it's a lot more methodical, a lot more needs to happen, your innate patience will get you to a point, but yet at the same time, if you want to maintain a kind of creative flow state or just be in the zone, whatever tool will get you there, at least for me, that was my mentality going in. Like whatever I could use to get to the end goal, I used it, and within a reasonable amount of time. So that's kind of where I'm coming from with that.
Yeah, which is the beauty of Unity, actually, is that it's really kind of, that's the point, is to like kind of bend it as much as you can to your needs and like break it a little bit. I mean, I'm pretty sure I've been using Playmaker in ways that like, I don't know. I taught myself how to program on YouTube, so like I usually cringe whenever anybody looks at my code, because I'm just like, I'm like, oh God, please, no. I think everybody has that reaction now that I've talked with more people. But yeah, it's like what you were saying. Like I come from, like I like drawing with ink in my sketchbook. And so like getting into games is really great because I like that methodical sort of way of getting to an end goal. And I really like messing with the numbers and I sucked at math in high school. And then I was like, turns out I'm actually can do trigonometry and I really like it. And I can do all these complex things and like create variables and work with vectors and 3D space. And it was really, really exciting. But at a certain point you're just like, okay, can I have like a curve that I can just pull things around and not have to type numbers and like wait for it to compile and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. So Playmaker is actually really great for that.
Yeah, it can be messy, but the mess is fine. I think making anything it gets messy.
If you can press play and it works, then like you're doing great.
Exactly.
I would second that. I don't use Playmaker. I'm like tangentially familiar with it, but like y'all might have noticed that Diaries like doesn't run super great all the time. And under the hood, it's like pretty much duct tape and spit and chewing gum and tears.
Yeah, I feel that for sure. I mean, with my own game, not with...
Right. I mean, like, well, I will say that it is something that I'm, at least with Diaries, like a little bit bummed about because, I mean, I wasn't originally planning on spending so much time on this game and making it so big. So that meant that like I didn't plan out the code very well or carefully or thoughtfully. So it all has sort of like collapsed like a house of cards around me as I've tried to like add stuff to the game. It's just been like, oh, I have to rewrite like some system that I did like a year ago and I don't remember what the hell was going through my mind.
I was gonna say like, I was like kind of going through some old code recently, just to, I don't know, do whatever. And the like what instantly came into my mind was like, if I had found like a mixed CD that I made when I was in like middle school or something, I'm just like looking at it, I'm just like, oh God, like what were you thinking? Yeah. Like how could you possibly think this was a good idea? Like that kind of thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like, oh, sorry. Go for it. Just like also, I want... it's an aspiration of mine that like the games that I make will be accessible eventually to people who don't play games. And like that didn't really shine through too much with Diaries because like it is a 3D game where you use a controller you control a camera and the movement of the player at the same time, and it's pretty confusing. But on top of that, it doesn't really work very well on like lower end hardware, which I think is super important. And a big goal, yeah, it's a big goal of mine for the future is like make sure that the games that you make are playable by people who don't have so much disposable income and stuff. Because I think that's really where the future of making video games is gonna be. Is not like if we keep staying in our own small bubble, shrinking bubble of an audience, we're gonna run into. And I feel like I'm probably preaching to the choir.
Yeah, that's super important for sure. Yeah.
Yeah. So, sorry.
I think we've got one question right here. Question for the live stream is about writing for interactive media and how you guys plan that out.
Yeah, I'll take this. So I had an arc in mind with the NORWOOD Suite. It's evolved a little bit, but I think it stays. The way that I want to commit to my project here is actually have it be the first in a series, but I don't want it to feel episodic. I kind of want to feel like each game is standalone, but they're all set in the same space. And so it becomes like, I guess, anthological, or it feels like graphic novels. It's like a series of discrete kind of short stories, and they all are set in the same place. And each one can have like a little mini arc. And I think for the medium and for the rate that I want to continue to release the work, that fits. And I guess I kind of just wing it a little bit, but I also do have these arcs in mind, like mini arcs that maybe hint at a larger arc for the character.
What do you use to actually write the dialogue? Do you have like an XML file or like JSON, or do you want to pull it up? Yeah. I'd love to see that.
So this is, let me just get.
I guess.
James, it's almost 1:30. Just.
Yeah, James has to catch an airplane. Do you want to talk about this a little before you go, or?
I guess all I'll say in terms of like its impact. Well, in Diaries, we did all the dialogue through like XML trees, and we kind of like there were a couple of things that we planned out from the start, just in terms of like the main storyline, and then as we've been making the game, we just like we'll pepper in conversations and dialogue. But like in terms of like the story itself, we concepted all of that at the very start because we wanted a game that, you know, sort of the crux of it is this comedic thing that like you're cursed and like you're walking around picking up trash while a skull yells at you. And that's sort of like the gist. And from that narrative idea, we like everything else sort of grew out of that. So we just like added conversations as we went. I also have a couple of other projects that are more writing based. I have this big Star Trek fan fiction project that some of you guys might have had the misfortune of hearing me rant about. But like one of my goals for that is actually to make it like into a viable like maybe mini series in the future somehow. I don't know, somehow. As like maybe a sort of Twine game, but in Unity, so 3D graphic novel-y with a little bit of maybe some like motion in there, sort of like a nice blend of different media into like a narrative mishmash of interesting science fiction. Because it'd be cool to do like an espionage character drama in the setting of Star Trek with original characters. I don't know. We'll see.
Can't wait.
This is the dialogue. This is how it's written in the game. It's just a text file with sort of a different keywords that tell it to jump to different people. Pretty pretty low rent, but it gets the job done.
I guess I just wanted to say too that, like, for me, it's a super weird process because I came from comics, and so, like, what it is for me is just, like, drawing. Like, I always just draw at work. Like, when I was working my butcher job, I was drawing on butcher paper when it was slow, and just kind of letting this character grow and grow and grow, going home and making a model, then doing the physics, then realizing the model didn't fit anymore, then fixing the model. And also, the main character is a little black girl, and that's not who I am. And so a lot of that was about, like, letting the character grow, like, giving it a seed of, like, what I wanted to see out of games, which is, like, less, which is more representation, basically. And but it was really important for me to bring on other voices that this character represented, and have them tell the story, and me sort of be, like, the sort of, like, conduit. Yeah, the conduit of where that character could go, and sort of, like, give it a space in a game world that was viable and fun to play. So that it was a new process for me to work in that way, but it was really important for me to kind of, like, learn and listen and do that, and kind of, like, take it from a place of being a static image to being this living, breathing character. Means there's a lot more you need to put into it, and a lot more thought you need to have. Maybe that's not the case with everybody, but that is definitely, like, what I felt when I was making the character in a video game as opposed to, like, drawing.
I think it was really important for us, sorry, to consult with or base our character off a real person, and really, like, taking notes and listening and being like, what would you put in a jar, and making sure that person, Iman, saw the character as we were developing her, and
I don't want to interrupt.
Worked out pretty well. Yeah,
I just wanted to say thank you guys so much. Thanks, huge thanks to Wiley and Brandon and Rachel and everyone who's organized Fantastic Fest.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah,
this was sort of really fun and great. And I'm so glad to be here and hope to come back in the future.
Your luggage is in my trunk, so
yes,
I have to
can
go
I,
too.
Got that.
Yeah. So, ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause for all of our guests.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You can play all of their games in the arcade until about 10 p.m. tonight.